scripture reading this morning. And the first one is not chapter 25 through 99. It's 9. Okay? I will be up there the rest of the afternoon. Second reading is Jeremiah chapter 18, 7 through 10, and Proverbs 14, 27 through 34. Then Jehoshaphat stood up in the assembly of Judah and Jerusalem at the temple of the Lord in front of the new courtyard and said, Lord, the God of our ancestors, you are not the God, are you not the God who is in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nation. Power and might are in your hand, and no one can withstand you. Our God, did you not drive out the inhabitants of this land before your people Israel and give it forever to the descendants of Abraham, your friend? They have lived in it and have built in it a sanctuary for your name, saying, if calamity comes upon us, whether the sword of judgment or plague or famine, we will stand in your presence before this temple that bears your name and will cry out to you in our distress, and you will hear us and save us. Jeremiah 18. If at any time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be uprooted, torn down, and destroyed, and if that nation, I warn, repents of its evil, then I will relent and not inflict on it the disaster I have planned. And if at another time I announce that a nation or kingdom is to be built up and planted, and if it does evil in my sight and does not obey me, then I will reconsider the good I had intended to do for it. And finally, Proverbs 14. The fear of the Lord is a fountain of life, turning a person from the snares of death. A large population is a king's glory, but without a subject, a prince is ruined. Whoever is patient has great understanding, but one who is quick-tempered displays folly. A heart at peace gives life to the body, but envy rots the bones. Whoever oppresses the poor shows contempt for their maker, but whoever is kind to the needy honors God. When calamity comes, the wicked are brought down, but even in death, the righteous seek refuge in God. Wisdom reposes in the heart of the discerning, and even among fools, she lets herself be known. Righteousness exalts a nation, but sin condemns any people. This is the word of the Lord.
The year is about 850 BC. The king sits in his palace, sunlight streaming through the windows, illuminating his throne. As he deals with the usual intrigues of the court, a gaggle of dirty, panting men burst through the door, causing a stir. The nobles murmur among themselves. The guards tense up, ready to defend the king. The men staggering, crying out, O king, live forever! We have terrible, terrible news. They tell the king that a large army, Moabites, Ammonites, and more, has gathered at Hazazon Tamar, preparing to attack. The kingdom is in grave danger. What's to be done? Can we call up enough trained men in time? The color drains from the king's face. Any other king would call for his generals, begin hashing out emergency military strategies. But this king is Jehoshaphat. He calls for his messengers, tells them to be ready to spread through the city and country, tells them it's time for a national day of prayer and fasting, a practice often followed millennia later by some folks across the wide blue ocean in some land called America, but Jehoshaphat doesn't need to know that. What Jehoshaphat does need is for the people of Judah to assemble, and he needs to get to the temple. There it stands, tall, sturdy, gleaming gold beneath the cloudless sky. The temple court was the only sensible place to meet the assembly. See, there's only one option in Jehoshaphat's thinking. They need to pray. And so he does. And stretching out his hands, raising his eyes toward that cloudless sky, squinting against that hot sun, Jehoshaphat raises his voice and calls out, "O Lord, God of our fathers, are you not God in heaven? You rule over all the kingdoms of the nations. In your hand are power and might, so that none is able to withstand you." Jehoshaphat called out to no generic God, no God of mild, milquetoast, civil religion, of tiresome fads and bland formalities, of empty gestures and empty hearts. No! Jehoshaphat called out to a God with a name, the Lord, Yahweh, the God who calls Israel his special people, the God distinguished in history by Abraham's devotion, the God whose temple gleamed in one holy city, the God later history would unveil as the Father sending the Son, the Son sending the Spirit filling a special people called from many tribes as one new humanity. That's the God Jehoshaphat invokes in a day of national trouble. Jehoshaphat had the unholy audacity to say that this God, this specific God, not Chemosh or Moab, not Baal, Canaanites, not Lady Liberty, not the Star Spangled Banner, not a divine butler, not a cosmic therapist, not a vague great spirit or universal force or ultimate concern or world soul or whatever tickles your fancy, not them, but this particular God was and is set apart from all other options, all possibilities, because this and only this God rules over all the kingdoms of the nations, no exceptions. This God, the God of Jehoshaphat's fathers, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob, rules over the kingdom of Israel and the kingdom of the Moabites, the kingdom of the Ammonites, the kingdom of the Edomites, the kingdom of the Russians, the kingdom of the English, and the ragtag kingdom of a bunch of disgruntled colonists called the Continental Congress. This God rules over all the kingdoms of the nations, and that is why we are here to worship this God this morning. Because he rules over all nations. What is a nation? We should know the words the Bible is using. Let me try to explain. In this verse, it's a people. Now that's a cultural and political community, broadly defined, bound together with the government that has sway over the people. That's a nation, a people and a government. Now every nation, every people and every government is accountable to this God. Every nation is accountable to the Lord. The Bible continually proclaims that God reigns over the nations. It says that kingship belongs to the Lord and he rules over the nations. The scripture calls the God of creation the King of the nations. That's in the Old Testament and in the New Testament. Every people is accountable to God, and so is every government. Now in the Bible, human government traces back to Genesis. Remember those words, "Whoever sheds the blood of man, by man shall his blood be shed, for God made man in his own image." We are authorized to carry out as best as we can the justice of God on earth. And God calls a requirement from his fellow man, "I will require a reckoning for the life of man." We are required to have government, to live in a fallen world. And so those who adopt special roles in governing a people are called God's servants. As we say in Romans, that the ruler does not bear the sword in vain, but is called God's servant, God's minister. In justice, we enjoy together the gifts God has given us, and to secure that enjoyment, for that reason, governments are instituted among men. So saith the Declaration of Independence. Just the same, every government is obligated to be just, obligated to serve the purposes of the God who rules over all kingdoms. And 240 years ago, the Americans believed, rightly or wrongly, separation from the British nation was warranted because that government became not just sloppy, but actively destructive of these ends through a long train of abuses. That's what they said in the Declaration of Independence, July 4th, 1776. So every nation, every people with its government, is accountable to the God who is king over all nations. The Bible and the Founding Fathers agreed on it. Sometimes this king chooses to build up or plant a new nation. Over 2 centuries ago, against daring odds, God granted success to the Continental Army in defense of the free and independent states that were declared by 13 seceding colonies. And God saw fit to draw the war to a close with the Treaty of Paris, thus making it clear God had planted a new nation that called itself the United States America. And God has since seen fit to build us up, not because we're special, but because that's what He decided. But, there's always a but, even when He declares it, take note, that nation, that kingdom, is always accountable. Consider the words of the prophet Jeremiah. If at any time I declare concerning a nation or kingdom that I will build and plant it, and if it does evil in my sight, not listening to my voice, then I will relent of the good that I intended to do. Jeremiah goes on to apply those words to a very unusual nation in Israel, but the principle is general. The book of Jonah makes that clear. It doesn't matter what reasons we have to think we're great. Even if God Himself has obviously blessed us, planned us, and built us up, if we nevertheless choose evil and refuse to listen, then we risk missing out on the good He had in store. That's what Jeremiah says. Thus saith the Lord. It obviously matters what a nation looks like in God's sight. If only there were some wisdom telling us what God is looking for. Can't imagine where we could find such a wisdom from God. Well, it just so happens we have one more key verse to cover. And let me tell you, this verse was a popular one in the colonies. When I was researching, I found so many dozens of sermons and letters quoting this one verse, I did not have time to even look at all of them. Not read all of them, just glance at them. That's how many there were in. And that verse says this: righteousness exalts a nation, but sin is a reproach to any. One pastor in 1769 called this a maxim founded on the experience of all ages. Another preacher said we should hear it because Solomon, who spoke it, was the greatest politician to ever live. Several men quoted this verse in letters to our earliest presidents, offering it as a reason why we should abolish slavery, because that sin is a reproach to our people. President John Adams quoted this verse, Proverbs chapter 14, verse 34, in a national fasting proclamation in 1799. He prayed that God would make all Americans deeply sensible of this verse's meaning for our life. That's a good prayer. It's a good prayer. So if we want to be deeply sensible of this verse, let's take a closer look at it. Nation, we know what that means. We talked about that. Exalt. There's an old-time word for you, exalt. Who outside church used the word exalt? Literally, it means raise high. The verse is about what raises or lifts a nation high. What makes a nation honorable? What puts a nation on top? Maybe not in strength, maybe not in wealth, maybe not in media or cultural influence, maybe not by any worldly standard whatsoever, but what puts a nation on top in God's measurement, by God's standard, in God's eye? That's an important question. What does it? What exalts a nation? That's the question of this morning's message. You heard the verse. It has the answer. Righteousness exalts a nation. Not big bucks. Not lots of swords and guns. Not popularity. Righteousness exalts a nation. In the early years of the Revolution, a pastor named Eden Burroughs preached a sermon on this verse. He summarized it as saying, righteousness is that wherein the real dignity and honor of a people consists. There's that word again. Righteousness. What is righteousness? There are so many definitions of righteousness. So many angles and uses and biblical studies and context, so much lexical debate and theological wranglings, book piling up on top of books. I have not bought them all yet. My mother's opinion notwithstanding. It is hard to know where to begin in defining righteousness. But let's try this one. Let's say righteousness is what happens when God appoints somebody to an office that's a station or a role, and they fulfill its responsibilities with virtue, and they use its powers and privileges rightly as defined by what God intends for that office to be doing. Righteousness is God puts somebody in a role, they fulfill its responsibilities, and they use its powers rightly as God defines it. That's an important definition this morning. Let's not lose sight of that. Here's an example. In creating the world and then dividing the peoples, God appoints himself as king of the nations. He fulfills that responsibility with perfect virtue. He uses his power rightly to do good to us. And so we call him righteous, because that's righteousness as king of the nations. Another example, in making a covenant with Abraham, God appoints himself savior of Abraham's family. And because God is faithful to that role, see the Exodus, because he uses his saving power rightly to redeem for himself all those who have faith, since Abraham is father of the faithful, well, because of all that, we call God a righteous God and Savior. That's righteousness. Here's another example. God creates us. God appoints us to be priests and kings of creation, caretakers of the garden. But we did not follow. We did not fulfill our responsibility. We did not use those privileges rightly. So the Bible tells us none is righteous. No, not one. In following Adam's blunder, we fail to be righteous before God. even if some in the Old Testament are called righteous in a relative sense. Ultimately, none is righteous, no, not one, because we did not follow through. Through our repeated failure, we were impeached and evicted from the garden and from office. But through Jesus Christ's resurrection, God re-elects us to that office. And now with the power of His Spirit in us, living in Christ, we have what Paul calls the righteousness of God that depends on faith. There's that righteousness again. Now, what does all this complexity have to do with exalting a nation? Well, there are plenty of offices we might hold. You might be elected president, senator, representative, mayor, county clerk. You might be appointed judge or get a cushy cabinet post. But there are more offices than those. There are more offices than the ones we hold election for. Being a citizen of a nation is an office. Being a citizen of these United States, that is an office. And whether you're elected or simply a citizen, being faithful to God's purposes with the responsibilities and powers of our office is called righteousness, so far as that office goes. And when a nation is faithful to God's purposes, when a nation exhibits justice, generosity, mercy, humility, well, that sounds to me like a nation where there is righteousness. That kind of righteousness exalted Jehoshaphat's Judah over the Moabites. And other nations are called to be exalted by righteousness too. A nation is exalted in God's sight to the degree righteousness is there, to the degree its citizens fulfill their offices virtuously and rightly unto God's purposes and glory. Isn't that a beautiful thought? In the midst of the revolution, pastor named Zabdiel Adams gave a sermon. He said, "Righteousness exalted the nation. It gives dignity, strength, and firmness to every body politic." 5 years later, another pastor, Joseph Buckminster, after the war's end, preached to the New Hampshire General Assembly. And Reverend Buckminster said, "As in divinity there can be no faith contrary to reason, so in politics there can be no wisdom contrary to righteousness. Righteousness exalted the nation, but sinners are reproached to any people. Righteousness is the rule of God's administration and ought to be the rule of theirs who reign and decree justice by it. And we the people, not just those we nominate in April or elect in November, hold office. We reign and decree justice by God. We need to be righteous." And yet righteous is not a word that comes very readily to mind when one thinks about the state of the Union in the year of our Lord 2016. It's easy to look out the window and complain. It's easier still to read the newspaper or flip on the TV and complain. We do it all the time. I speak from personal experience. Because I do. However you plan to vote or not vote come November, I think it's fair to say virtually no one in America looks at the state of the campaign and thinks, these are reasonable options. Scarcely anyone thinks well of even the candidate they plan to vote for. It's true, they've done polls. For neither candidate do the majority of supporters say they like the candidate. They don't think of themselves as voting for someone, they think of themselves as voting against someone else. As nation, we are not excited. We're angry. We're scared. We're frustrated. We are neither united nor exalted. And like one pastor quipped 217 years ago tomorrow, if government be not wisely administered, the fault must be in the people. Ouch. This year increasingly reminds me of the Bible's description of God giving people up to the rotten fruit of their sin. That's a sobering thought. It's my personal thought. It is easy to get frustrated and complain about God. It is easy to get frustrated and complain about politics. It's easy to get frustrated and complain about court decisions, and there have been a lot of questionable ones. It is easy to get frustrated and complain about the culture. It's easy to get frustrated and complain about our neighbors. But the truth is, a righteous nation starts one and only one place, with a righteous mean and a righteous view. We hold office. As Americans, we hold office as citizens. Some of you hold the office of parent or grandparent. Some of you hold the office of employer. As Christians, we hold the office of royal priest. Each of these offices comes with responsibilities and powers and privileges. Each of these offices calls for virtue. Each offers opportunities that we can squander or we can use to love God and love our neighbors and our neighborhoods. A righteous nation starts here. An exalted nation starts here. A century ago yesterday, one of our United Evangelical pastors, a man named H.B. Barshinger, I'm glad that's not my name, Reverend Barshinger wrote a Christian Endeavor message, Christian Endeavor, here we go, titled An Ideal Nation. He wrote, "It does not matter how much we philosophize or materialize, it still remains true that righteousness is just as essential to the strength and permanence of a nation as to the welfare of the individual. Every lawful activity, no matter on what side it touches humanity, needs to be brought into harmony with what God demands." Reverend Barshinger went on to pose the question, when would our nation be ideal? He meant, when will our nation be righteous? What would that look like? You know what he came up with? Let me read you a quick passage here. "When we as a nation practice what we put on our coins, in God we trust. As long as we continue to harbor our national sins and put our trust in an increased army and an augmented navy, we are simply inviting disaster. We will be ideal when each individual strives to be an ideal citizen. When sacred office comes to be regarded as a sacred trust. When there is a supreme regard for the welfare of the masses and not the greedy affluence of privileged classes. When a poor widow has just as much a chance to obtain her rights before a civil court as the millionaire. When it is no longer true that the man who steals a chicken goes to the penitentiary while the man who loots a bank goes to Canada. When great public evils are no longer permitted to flourish in order to fill the pockets of a few capitalists." After saying those things, Reverend Barshinger asked, "What can we do? How can we make our nation ideal? How can we foster the righteousness of our nation?" And he came up with five things. The first thing, before anything else, is by focusing on our own hearts, our own lives, and then those around us. Righteousness is a grassroots thing. He wrote, this may be done by each one sweeping before his own door. And then when that is done, helping his neighbor if he has not yet finished his job. Righteousness starts in my heart, your heart, for the work of God. Second, Barshinger called on the church to have a larger vision. Not a politicized gospel, but to see every field of human endeavor, every office or role with all its activities, as accountable to God. God is not content with the churchy hour of your week. Church member is an incredible office, but God is Lord over all your offices and all your actions. God is Lord over all of you and all of your neighbors and all of America's people and all of America's government, no matter who likes it or who doesn't. As Americans, as humans, we are God's subjects. But how great it is through Jesus Christ our Lord to be citizens of God's kingdom. For it is written, our citizenship is in heaven, and from it we await a Savior, Lord Jesus Christ. Third, Reverend Barshinger said, the ministry of the country must bend to its stupendous task of awakening and educating the public conscience. Every minister must come into his pulpit red hot with a thus saith the Lord, and not labor to find what suits the people. What good words. That one's on me. And I try to live. I try to focus on what God has said, to hear his voice for us each and every week, and to proclaim it without regard to popularity. I hope that's what I'm doing. But your prayers, your encouragement, and your real engagement with the message go a long, long way. Fourth, Reverend Barshinger invites us to be our whole selves, even in church. In his words, every citizen should not only vote as he prays, but pray as he votes. Now, what he goes on to explain his meaning is, if we don't wear a mask to church, if we really had to confess our votes as we pray here, we might learn something from looking in our hearts and finding what kind of votes can we confess with a good conscience before God's people. Now, I don't think Barshinger was being completely literal. I don't think Reverend Barshinger meant that after an election we should have a prayer service where we go out around and say out loud who we voted for. I don't think that's what he's actually calling for, but it doesn't even point. So often we get mired down in pragmatism when we think about anything we call political. But pragmatism gets swept away as soon as we're forced to confess not just our votes, but our actions and attitudes. And we have to face the demands of not only conscience, but the gospel's truth. In other words, when we have to bring our actions, our attitudes, inside and outside the voting booth, before the light of the gospel, when we have to own up to it in our conscience, and with the community of faith looking on, seeing all secrets laid bare, we might learn a lot about what we can confess in good conscience and good faith and what we can't. And if we resolve to go forward with what we can confess in good conscience alone, we might see our lives and our nation change. That's what Reverend Barshinger is saying there. And fifth, Reverend Barshinger ended his lesson by saying, we must determine our political acts in the light of the obligations which are God's wonderful providences in our history imposed upon us. In other words, once again, we are accountable to God. We are accountable to God. There's a silver lining Even if we seem to be failing, even if we seem to be struggling, there's hope. Because I only quoted half of Jeremiah's message. There's another half. And that half says, if at any time I declare concerning a nation or a kingdom that I will pluck up and break down and destroy, and if that nation concerning which I have spoken turns from its evil, I will relent of the disaster that I intended to do to it. That's good word. But that turning starts not with the president, not with the candidates, not with the news items, but with you and me, here and now. As Christians, we are called to have Jehoshaphat's kind of faith. To see the Lord we serve, the Lord who showed his face as Jesus, the Lord who paid for our unrighteousness on the cross, the Lord who buried our sin in his tomb and left it behind, the Lord who rose again to deathless life, the Lord who re-elected us to office as his co-heirs and as citizens, not just of America, but more importantly of God's kingdom. We need faith to see that that Lord is the God who rules over all the kingdoms of the nations. We read that Jehoshaphat's faith in the Lord was not in vain. The Moabite coalition collapsed in on itself at God's command. The people of Judah had nothing to do but three things: stand by, watch, and gather the spoils. And nor will our faith be in vain if the one we trust is the same Lord who died and rose, so that we can stand free from our burdens, watch his beauty unfold in history, and gather up the treasure of heaven, yea, even eternal life. In his power, or in his hand, are power and might, and a vacant hold the width of the Roman nail. That is the Lord we serve. That is King of the nations. If we live by that faith, if we trust him and follow him and love him and serve him, if we rely on his spirit and not our own strength, that is what he reckons to us as righteousness. And that is what we live out in all our roles, our offices, here and now. And then, only then, will we know the truth of what Daniel Batwell preached in 1775 in these last words. Were we but all convinced that righteousness exalted the kingdom while sinners are reproached to any people? And did we sanctify this conviction by practice? What a glorious, what a delightful scene of things would immediately present itself to our view. O Lord, God and Father of Jesus Christ, God of Abraham, God of Jehoshaphat, King of the nations, make us righteous in this trying hour, and thereby may our nation be exalted. Amen. Amen. Thanks be to God.